Now, okay. Now we are starting. Today is 140th Friday group meeting. The topic is Rationalizing the Juvenile Justice Law. The speaker is Dr. Aman M.Hingorani, one of the promise young advocate. He's doing a lot of work. I request Shashi Singh will read his CV, a few this time.
It's my privilege and honor to introduce Dr. Aman M.Hingorani. He had been my teacher also in ILI as in the arbitration course. He has topped the AOR examination of Supreme Court, and he had been a gold medalist in that examination. He is an empaneled arbitrator in Delhi High Court, PhD Chamber of Commerce, and even in Supreme Court Mediation Center. He has a lot of academic stint with him. He has taught in National Judicial Academy, Bhopal, Delhi, Campus Law Center, University of Delhi, Indian Law Institute, New Delhi, and Trichy, Mumbai, as well as in foreign colleges, Keble College, University of Oxford, UK, Law School, Warwick University, UK, South Asian Institute of Advanced Legal and Human Rights Studies, Dhaka. He has also been instrumental in preparing the courses for Bar Council of India, modules for Indo-British Project on Advocacy Skills, British Council, ADR Manual for FICCI, and PhD Chamber of Commerce. Besides that, he had been on various panels, and he had been in Legal Services Committee of Supreme Court. He was also counsel for the Nirbhaya case, and related with the he challenged the constitutional validity of the juvenile justice in that particular case. He has also written a very famous and bestseller book, Unraveling the Kashmir Knot, and he has given some practical solutions for Kashmir issue. This book has been endorsed by many luminaries, armed forces people, and many journalists. He has, to his credit, more than 52 publications, both national and international. He has also been involved in a lot of PIL cases, Bhopal gas strategy, intellectual property matters, and so on. Over to Dr.
Thank you, Shashi. Sir, 45 minutes your speech, 15 minutes question answer. So we'll introduce one by one. I'm G.Seshagiri, myself.
Well, thank you, friends, for being here for this particular talk on juvenile justice law. Let me start with the latest decision of the Supreme Court, which was in the matter of Shilpa Mittal versus State of NCT, 2020 Volume 1, Scale 657. Let's just see the facts of that case. This person, this boy, who was 4 days short of being 18, took his father's Mercedes for a ride. He drove over somebody, killed somebody. As per the decision of the Supreme Court in this case, what he has done is a serious offense, because though the sentence is more than 7 years, there is no minimum sentence prescribed. And so it's a serious offense, which means blanket immunity from criminal process. He has to be treated as a juvenile. He can't be tried by a criminal court under Section 304. Culpable homicide not amounting to murder. He must be sent to the Juvenile Justice Board for rehabilitation, etc. So here you have a situation. There was no dispute, there was no question, there was not even argument that this person did not have the emotional, mental, intellectual, physical maturity or capacity to know what he's doing. There's no dispute that he had the ability to know the nature and consequences of his actions. So there's no dispute. So think about it this way. If he has committed this offense on a Monday, he goes to the juvenile justice system. He commits this offense on a Friday, he goes to the court. That is how arbitrary our juvenile justice law is. Take another situation, and this is also inspired by a real case. A person, a 12-year-old boy studying in school, another 5-6 students, the same batchmates, 12-year-olds, decide they have a fight with him, they hit him with knives, they kill this child. They throw the body of this child on the railway tracks. 2 days later, the parents of the child find him, body is full of maggots, they can't even recognize the body. 12 years, juvenile, go for rehabilitation, maximum you can be there for 3 years. End of 3 years, the experts who were trying to rehabilitate or reform these children tell the JJ board, they are so hardened, we can't reform them. They will go out, they'll commit another crime. Law obliges them to be released after 3 years. Courts are helpless, police is helpless, JJ board is helpless. 15 years, they are released, they go and rape a 5-year-old girl. So these are instances, and these are actual cases. Instances about how our juvenile justice system needs to be revisited. Let us just examine what is the current act, what does the JJ Act 2015 say, and then we can see where the law needs to be changed. It's not an issue of only of age, it's not a debate of 16, 18, as has been as normally understood. It is much more than that. Now, the JJ Act basically defines a child. The 2015 Act has certain changes over the 2000 Act. Instead of juvenile, we say child in conflict of law to make it more child-friendly. So a child in conflict of law is a person who is less than 18 and who is alleged to have committed an offence or was found to have committed an offence. The Act contemplates a JJ board, magistrate with two social workers, one of them a lady, who will try to see, who will deal with that particular situation when a child in conflict with law is brought before the board. The Act provides that there's a legal presumption, there's a presumption of innocence, that the child could never commit an offence. The minute a child is brought before the police station, he can't be put in police lockup, he has to be sent to the board. If the child is produced before the court must send it to the board. So no detention in police lockup or jail for a child under 18. Now the JJ board is supposed to see whether he's committed an offence. In a child-friendly environment, not strictly adversarial, with the view to see what are the circumstances so we can rehabilitate this child. The idea is rehabilitation, reformation, reintegration into society. That's the purpose of JJ Act. Now the Act classifies offences under the IPC and other any other law in three categories. Petty offences, sentence up to 3 years. Serious offences, 3 to 7 years. Heinous offences, more than 7 years. And the fourth category of cases, which now the court has found, but was not in the JJ Act, where the sentence is more than 7 years, but no minimum sentence prescribed. Culpable homicide not amounting to murder, abetment to suicide of a child or an innocent person, counterfeiting of currency, these are all offences where there is no minimum sentence prescribed. And according to court, these fall within serious offences, not heinous, till Parliament steps in. So basically three categories of offences: petty, serious, heinous. For petty and serious offences, there's a blanket immunity for a person below 18-year-old that he will never be tried in a court. There has to be rehabilitation. For 16 to 18, the JJ board can decide whether this person had the maturity and the capacity to commit that offence, and then can send it, and for that the board can make assessment taking help of experts. Should the board feel, no, this person did not have capacity, then you have the same provisions of rehabilitation. If the board feels this person had the capacity, then the board sends the person to the children's court. The children's court will also apply its mind, did this person have the capacity? If he did, then he can be tried as an adult. If it did not, rehabilitation. Not only, but even there, there's a further beneficial provision that even if a child is to be tried as an adult, he has to be kept in a place of safety till he turns 21. And throughout this period of 18 to 21, he has to be given rehabilitation measures. And after 21, he goes and is treated like a normal adult. So broadly speaking, this is the scheme of the JJ Act. What I'm concerned with is, well, what's the crux of the problem is a blanket immunity, not case by case basis. The purpose of JJ Act is laudable because we actually don't want to give children to the police. We know the way our criminal system works. I mean, if they go in, they may never come out. And if they come out, they may come out as hardened criminals. Police reforms haven't happened, custodial violence is there, rape is there, abuse is there. So you're writing off the children by sending them to jail, to the police. So that is, nobody has a doubt about that. And in fact, we must strengthen the JJ system because we don't have, we have poorly trained benches, we don't have the implementation proper, we don't have the infrastructure. The observation homes are dens of crime now. Children are misused, abused in the observation homes, in the children's homes. So we need to strengthen that to get to make the JJ Act work. So while the purpose is fine of the JJ Act, where is the problem? And that problem, according to me, is giving blanket immunity to everyone under 18 for a serious and petty offence, and under 16 for a heinous offence. That's one side of it. And also by requiring the JJ board from taking a decision as to whether this individual had the maturity or not. And let me explain why. Before the JJ Act, and in this incident, in this case, Shilpa Mittal's case, the Supreme Court has given the entire historical background on the juvenile justice law. Before we had the JJ Act, we had Section 82, 83 of the IPC. Section 82 of the IPC basically said nothing in offence if committed by a person less than 7 years. Section 83 said if the child person is between 7 to 12 years, then the court will see whether this person had the maturity to understand the nature and consequences of his actions. So it was a judicial function. The court could take help of experts, but this was a judicial function the way we do it for people of insane mind. There's always a fine inquiry about insanity. And the court can take help from experts to see whether this person is a lunatic or not. And there's a finding, subject to appeal. So it was a judicial function for the court to decide the mental maturity of a person alleged to have committed an offence. If he had the maturity, try him as an adult. If he did not have a maturity, it's not an offence. So the legislative intent was, where you have the maturity, you must be tried as an adult. That was broadly the law. Then came the successive JJ Acts, and in 2000 it was anybody below 18, blanket immunity. Now this particular provision, the JJ Act, with giving blanket immunity, has effectively taken away the judicial function of deciding whether this person should be tried as an adult or not. It outs judicial discretion. If you see the case law, Mithu's case, I'm sure all of you have read, Mithu versus State of Punjab, I can give the citation. That is 1983, 2 SCC, 277. Constitutional decision where section 303 IPC was struck down. 303 basically said, whoever under a sentence of imprisonment for life commits murder, he shall be hung. Death penalty. No discretion. This provision was challenged before the Supreme Court, and they said it is judicial function to see the circumstances should this person get death penalty or not? How can legislature say, tie down the hands of the court, make the court a silent spectator, that regardless of the facts, regardless of the circumstances, regardless of the gravity of offense, you have no choice, you have to hang him. So the Supreme Court struck down the section as being unconstitutional, saying you are ousting judicial discretion. This is legislative adjudication. You're basically taking away the discretion. I can even quote what the Supreme Court has said. A provision of law which deprives the court of the use of its wise and beneficent discretion in the matter of life and death without regard to the circumstances in which the offence was committed and therefore without regard to the gravity of offence cannot but be regarded as harsh, unjust, unfair. Legislature cannot make relevant circumstances irrelevant, deprive the courts of the legitimate jurisdiction to exercise discretion and compel them to shut their eyes. This is a case where, for another proposition, that the core of our criminal justice system is that you cannot have blanket orders, you cannot have a standard. You can't, there's the impossibility of laying standards is at the very core of the criminal law as administered in India. It has to be on a case-by-case basis. You can't have one prescription for everybody. So this was Mithu's judgment. I had occasion of using this judgment to strike down 32A of the NDPS Act. What 32A of the NDPS Act basically said, if somebody is convicted under the NDPS Act, he files an appeal, the appellate court cannot suspend a sentence. Earlier, the view was this bar was for basically remission by the executive, but in another judgment, Maktool Singh's case, the Supreme Court had laid down, Justice Thomas' judgment was there, that this also applies to courts. So the net result was, if a person who's convicted in the appellate, under the NDPS, he wants to file an appeal to say it's a case of mistaken identity, I'm not the person. The court say, yeah, we know you're not the person, but we have no power, we can't suspend your sentence. And sentence is minimum 10 years. So in this case, Jiti was a state Union of India, it was tagged on with another matter, Dadu. The citation is AIR 2000, Supreme Court 3203, AIR 2000, Supreme Court 3203. I challenged this particular provision saying, sentencing is judicial function, suspension of sentence is judicial function. How can Parliament, by law, by statute, take away the judicial function of to give sentence or to suspend the sentence? Relying on Mithu that you can't take away judicial function or judicial discretion. There's a whole body of law, as you all know, about what are the principles for sentencing. That's the law laid down by the court. The principles is a judicial discretion. How can Parliament take away the judicial decision? And I relied on Cooley's constitutional limitations, which basically talked about the difference of powers between Parliament and judiciary, which says Parliament cannot take cases out of the settled course of judicial process. You can't pick and choose and say, well, this case will not be decided by the court. It's the court's job to decide a controversy affecting to life and death of people. It's the court's job to see the adequacy, sufficiency of evidence. So you can't take away judicial discretion, it is basically Parliament adjudicating, and that hits separation of powers. So again, in this particular case, the Supreme Court struck down 32A to the extent it took away judicial discretion of the appellate court of suspending the sentence. And the Supreme Court again had held, I can read it from there, legislature cannot make law to deprive courts of the legitimate jurisdiction conferred under the procedure established by law. Exercise of judicial discretion on well-recognized principle is the safest possible safeguards for an accused, which is at the very core of the criminal law administered in India. And then the court went on to talk about judicial review, etc., the scheme of the Constitution to say 32A, insofar as it outs the jurisdiction of the court to suspend the sentence awarded to the convicted under the Act, is unconstitutional. So there are two decisions which we had, Mithu and Dadu, when we came to Nirbhaya's case. whereas you know one person was a juvenile, 17 plus. So we challenged the 2000 Act, JJ Act, to the extent it gave blanket immunity to an accused, a person under 18, even where that person had the maturity to know the nature and consequences of his actions. If a person is involved in gang rape or rape, he knows what he's doing. He knows the nature of his actions. He knows the consequences of his actions. Should that person be given a blanket immunity from the criminal process? And again, relying on these two judgments, that under the JJ Act, there is no trial, there is no punishment. It's a child-friendly inquiry against a juvenile to understand the circumstances why he committed the offense so that he can be rehabilitated. It can be sent for rehabilitation, he can be reformed. So you're giving a blanket immunity from the criminal process. In this case, however, the Supreme Court did not accept this argument. In para 38 of the judgment, the Supreme Court spelt out the difference between the JJ Act and the criminal justice law, agreed with the contention that there's no trial, there's no punishment, it's a different system altogether. Having held that, in the same judgment, in para, this was in para 38, in para 47, the court went on to say, it is a different system, but there's still, if I can put it in inverted commas, there's a different scheme for trial and punishment. After having held that there's no trial and punishment. So if you read this particular judgment, you will see that in, if you just read paras 38 and 47, then direct contradiction with each other. In 38, they say there is no trial, there is no punishment. It's a child-friendly inquiry to rehabilitate the juvenile. In para 47, they say it's a different scheme of trial and punishment, and so nothing so drastic has happened so as to strike down the JJ Act to this extent. The argument was very simple. It is judicial discretion to see whether this person has the mental maturity, the capacity. The minute a person is brought before the court, let the court assess that mental maturity. In some places, people are not mature till the age of 21. Sometimes they've been exposed to such conditioning or social conditions, dehumanizing poverty, crime, that they are hardened at the age of 12, 14. It depends on person to person. In each case, let the court apply its judicial mind to see whether this person had the mental maturity and the capacity. If he had, try him like an adult. If you did not, send him to the juvenile board, even if he is 19 and 20. It has to be a case-to-case basis. Age or criminal responsibility cannot be the exclusive or conclusive factor to see whether there should be a trial or not. So that was the point which was being made. As also the point that you're taking away judicial discretion vested in Section 82-83. In Act 83, the judicial discretion is being taken away. So the Supreme Court did not accept this, but as a result of this, law was amended, 2015 Act, which now said between 16 to 18, the board will decide. Now, there are two issues about that. What if a child is now 15 years, 11 months, and 25 days? Same defect, blanket immunity. From 18, you brought him to 16. What about 16, one day less than 16? He's again blanket immunity. And secondly, which is the body to which you have given the power to decide the maturity? The board. The board is not a court. Board is a magistrate with two social workers. That power had to be given to the magistrate, a judicial magistrate, or to the court, as it is under Section 83. Because it's a judicial discretion, cannot be substituted by a body like the JJ board. So that is where, which is the flaw in the 2015 judgment act also, that firstly, it gives blanket immunity to everybody for a petty and serious offense under 18. it gives blanket immunity to everybody under 16 for heinous offence. From 16 to 18, it gives the power to the board and not to the court to decide the mental maturity and capacity of that particular child in conflict with law. Now, what the Act says, 2000 Act as well as the 2015 Act, they refer for taking this particular scheme to certain international conventions, Beijing rules. They talk about the Convention of the Rights of Child, they talk about United Nations standards of minimum rules for admission of juvenile justice, the Beijing rules, United Nations rules for protection of juveniles deprived of the liberty. If you go through each of these international covenants, none of them require ousting the jurisdiction of the domestic court. On the contrary, each convention contemplates adjudication by a court. The international covenants which the state is relying on actually requires adjudication. They don't say take away the power from the domestic court. So this is not in line with the international practice anyways, what we have done in this country. I don't think any other country has what we have done. Give blanket immunity from criminal process. Now, and again, since we don't have the time, I won't take you through the different provisions, though I have culled them out. But even if there's an international convention which says outs the jurisdiction of the domestic court, it would be inconsistent with our constitutional scheme. The treaty-making power, again, is subject to constitutional limitations. So again, that particular convention could not be incorporated into domestic law. Now, this is one aspect of the matter. See it from the, when is the law invalid? One, when of course there's an implied constitutional prohibition, but also, and of course the other is Article 14, which you all, as you all know out here, the preamble says this particular law act has been enacted under 15 clause 3, 39 E and F, 45 and 47. A law under these provisions also needs to satisfy the test of Article 14. So let us see whether Article 14 is violated. For that, let us see, and we know the twin test, that you can have classification based on the intelligible differentia, which distinguishes people within a group from people left outside that group. And that basis must have a rational nexus with the object of the act. Right? Now, what is the basis of classification? What's the differentia? Differentia is those people should not be tried by the criminal courts who do not have the mental capacity or maturity to know what they are doing. That's why they should be rehabilitated, they should be reformed, they should be socially reintegrated, because they don't have the emotional, mental, physical, intellectual maturity or capacity. They don't have the ability to know the nature and consequences of their actions. That's the reason, that's the premise of JJ, of juvenile justice law. So that is the reason for classification. What is the object? Object is there in the preamble. It is a law to consolidate and amend the law relating to children alleged and found to be in conflict with laws and children in need of care and protection by catering to the basic needs through proper care, protection, development, treatment, social integration, by adopting a child-friendly approach in the adjudication and disposal of matters in the best interest of children and for the rehabilitation through processes provided and institutions bodies established here under. So basically it is reformation, rehabilitation, social reintegration. That's the object. So the basis is people who don't have the maturity or the capacity, which must have nexus with the object of rehabilitation, reformation, social reintegration. Now, if you go back to Ambika Mills case, I give you the citation, 1974 SCR Volume 3, 760. 1974 SCR Volume 3, 760, Ambika Mills, the State of Gujarat of the Sri Ambika Mills with the Constitution Bench has explained Article 14. Very importantly, explained the concepts of where a statute is bad, where a classification is bad for being under-inclusive and over-inclusive. if it is under inclusive, if leaves out from the classification other similar things. It's over inclusive if it includes in the classification people or things which should not be there. If we step back and think, what has this JJ Act done? This JJ Act has said that anyone under the age of 18 for petty and serious offences and under 16 for heinous offences will get blanket immunity from the law regardless of whether they have or don't have the mental maturity or capacity. So this is a case of an over-inclusive classification, because in this classification you've included people who have the capacity and maturity, who do not need that reformation, rehabilitation or social integration offered to people who don't have the maturity and capacity. Is this clear, or would you like me to repeat it? That in this particular classification, the idea is to protect people who don't have maturity or capacity to know the nature and consequences of what they're doing. If in that classification you also include people below that age, but who have that capacity and maturity, then that inclusion, those category of people have no nexus with the object of the act. So for that reason, this provision is again hit by Article 14. So we have in this country been left with a situation where you have a law which says if a person is below a particular age, 15 years, 11 months, 29 days, and he commits any offence, nobody can touch him. And that itself is a proposition that cannot stand in law. And for 16 to 18, you have taken away judicial discretion which was vested in the court by Section 83. So relying on Mithu, relying on Dadu's case, two judgments directly on the point, this particular law should be challenged, needs to be challenged, more so in case of this recent judgment I started with of the year 2020. It's a decision on 9th of January this year, where the courts have said, they think about it, this is a person who has committed culpable homicide not amounting to murder, 304. It says, the court says we're treating it as serious merely because no minimum sentence is there. The legislation, the parliament forgot this category of cases altogether. JJ Act does not contemplate offence where there is no minimum punishment, where the sentence is more than 7 years but no minimum punishment, that is not even contemplated by the JJ Act. It has been treated as casually as that. The Supreme Court has said we are treating it as serious offence. So if a person is 17 years, 11 months, 29 days, he is going to be given a blanket immunity. One day later, he has to be tried as an adult. If the law is struck down to the extent that it has to be done on a case-to-case basis, that does not mean that we are sending the child into prison with hardened criminals. You can still give the provisions which are there. The reason why I give the scheme, that even those which the children's court says sent for trial, they are not made to sit with hardened prisoners. They are given they're put in a place of safety till they're 21. They're given rehabilitation measures. There's anyway a bar in the JJ Act that is that they can't be tried jointly. A juvenile cannot be given death penalty or life imprisonment without possibility of release. All those beneficial provisions can be made available to a person which a court feels is less than 18 but had the maturity and capacity to know the nature and consequences of what they're doing. So nobody's suggesting they put them with under 12 prisoners or with hardened criminals. There are different mechanisms already existing. So that's the only way, what in my view, is to rationalize the juvenile justice law, is to make it by a case-to-case basis and let the court decide. Let the court decide whether this person should be tried as an adult or not. So with that, since it's about 40 minutes, I'll rather have questions because it is a slightly different take on the juvenile justice law. So I'm sure there must be people wanting to ask questions on this. So the floor is open. I'm open for cross-examination or being grilled.
So there are cases where even the victim is under 18 or under 14. So their right is also affected.
Yes, that is also a counterpoint. Like the case I gave about this 12-year-old student, they raped a 5-year-old girl. What about her rights? So, but that is one consideration. But then the major consideration is, should the mental maturity and capacity be the test along with age, or should age alone be the conclusive factor to decide whether a person should be sent in the juvenile justice system? Any other questions, doubts, clarifications, comments? Yes.
Actually, there has to be some line where we have to define that this is a child and this is an adult. You said it is violative for Article 14 because it is an over-inclusive classification. Over-inclusive. So you can also argue the other way, that is under-inclusive because a person may be about 80 and he is still not mature. So we have to have an age.
You are talking
about the age of 21. So 21 we are also marking. So we have to mark it somewhere.
You are right. So we have to have an age. But is it age only? Or should it be age plus mental capacity?
But sir, then in that case it would be subjective to the judges because every judge will have to decide.
So that is what Section 83 provides for. And for that you can take help of experts. There is a whole remedy of appeal. Right now, who's deciding it? The JJ board. A magistrate and two social workers are deciding this precise question between 16 to 18, the mental maturity. Yes. Here I'm saying whether it's 16, whether it's 14, whether it's 21. Let a court as opposed to a board decide that. And that because, not because for any other reason, but it is traditionally a judicial function. If the Indian Penal Code made as a judicial function, and if you can do it for people of unsound mind.
But we have to mark the age somewhere, sir.
Age is not an issue. That's why I say, I am not on the debate of age. I am not on the age whether it should be 18, 16, 14 or 21. Take whichever date you want to take. Take whichever age you want to take. But age alone cannot be the decisive factor.
Don't take away the judicial function from the
judicial function, and also see whether that person, regardless of the age, had the mental maturity and capacity to know the nature and consequences of the actions. If you introduce that as a factor, which is already there in Section 83, it's not something which is coming for the first time. It is already there in Section 83, which has been taken away by the JJ Act. And to that extent, we are ousting judicial discretion and hijacking a judicial function. And this is again legislative adjudication, where Parliament is taking cases out of the settled course of judicial proceedings. You are identifying cases. This age, take this case out of the judicial process, put it before the JJ board. That, according to Cooley's constitutional limitations and many other scholars, is unconstitutional. It violates the judicial, the scope reserved for the judiciary. So to that extent, again, so you're right, there has to be an age. As well as how do you define juvenile? How do child define a child?
We have to draw a line.
Sir, inclusion of doctors, psychologists in juvenile justice board can sort out this problem somewhere.
Well, in fact, the provision provides that when the juvenile justice board draws a preliminary assessment as to whether this person between 16 to 18 had the capacity, they can take recourse to doctors, psychologists, experts. But then so can a judge. I mean, there's a time for insanity if you can send people to Niman, so you can send people, get a certificate, and let there be a finding. And that's it, then the person is sued through the next friend. And there again, the principles underlying this is judicial discretion. Somehow I would trust a judicial body more than an executive body. Not because of being a lawyer, but because there's a whole hierarchy of appeal and first appeal, second appeal. What if the magistrate and the social worker, who themselves may not be qualified, take a decision that this person does not have the maturity when he had the maturity? See it from the point of the victim, who might be a minor. So that discretion has to be not an executive discretion, it has to be a judicial discretion.
Yeah. Any more questions? I mean, yeah, Rahul, please.
So there is a convention on the CRC, new convention on the child's rights. So it gives immunity to, like, it gives protection to children who are under 18, like they can't be sent into army in country missions and all, and they can't be punished to in courts. So by the this matter of maturity, so wouldn't it be applicable in sending children into?
Well, that convention actually does not give immunity. Because I wanted questions, I did not really go through that, but I can read out to you certain provisions of the convention or the CRC you're talking about. Article 40, Clause 2, Subclause A ensures that no child shall be alleged as or be accused of or recognized as having infringed the penal law by reason of acts of commission that were not prohibited by the national international law at the time when they've committed. 42 clause B mandates that every child alleged or accused of having infringed the penal law, that means they can infringe the penal law, should have the following guarantees specified, including the guarantee, and these are the guarantees: to have the matter determined without delay by a competent, independent and impartial authority or judicial body. So there is no immunity. In a fair hearing according to law and in the presence of legal or other appropriate assistance, and unless it is considered not to be in the best interest of the child in particular, taking into account his or her age or situation, his or her parents or legal guardians. The next guarantee is not to be compelled to give testimony or to confess guilt, to examine or have examined adverse witnesses. So a juvenile is entitled to examine witnesses, and to obtain the participation examination of witnesses on his or her behalf under the condition of equality. If considered to have infringed the penal law, to have this decision and any measures imposed in consequence thereof reviewed by a higher, competent, independent, impartial authority should body according to law. So it actually contemplates not immunity, it contemplates adjudications, an impartial one subject to appeal, the whole body of appeal and review by a higher body. So the premise from which you are saying that this particular convention says there has to be immunity, it's not there. The Act says we are relying on this convention, but the convention didn't say that. Even the next convention, United Nations Standard of Minimum Rules for Administration of Juvenile Justice, which is cited in the preamble, requires in Rule 6.1 that appropriate scope of discretion should be allowed at all stages of proceedings and at all different levels of juvenile justice administration, including investigation, prosecution, adjudication and follow-up dispositions. They actually talk about prosecutions. Rule 17 lays down the guiding principles in adjudication and disposition, including the mandate that deprivation of personal liberty shall not be imposed unless the juvenile is adjudicated of a serious act involving violence against another person or persistence in committing other serious offences unless there is no other appropriate response. And finally, just one line of the last convention, United Nations Rules for Protection of Juveniles Deprived of Liberty mandates that the length of sanction of such deprivation should be determined by a judicial authority, though without precluding the possibility of his or early release, defines deprivation of liberty to include imprisonment, while declaring that imprisonment should be used as last resort. Rules specifically provide for detailed guidelines for juveniles under arrest or awaiting trial. So the international covenants relied on by the Juvenile Justice Act in the preamble actually talk about adjudication, talk about prosecution, talk about what are the guidelines to be followed awaiting while being arrested or awaiting trial. There is no provision in any international covenant which says give blanket immunity to people below this particular age. So where is it that we're getting that from? Right? Any other question?
Is there any prohibition like not sending children armed forces in the CRC convention for the rights of children?
Not to my knowledge. I mean, I assume there may be many other, because for armed forces, there are many bodies of law which actually talk about that you can't use children in war, etc. There's bound to be prohibition somewhere or the other, whether it's here or not, I'm not aware, but there's bound to be that prohibition. But here it's a different situation.
So, what do you think about Nirbhaya case? Like, the juvenile was the most brutal amongst all of them, but he was not hanged, and he was saved because his age was, he was a minor.
Yeah, but you see, first of all, having appeared for the family in Nirbhaya's case, there's nothing on record to show that he was the most brutal.
Yeah.
Number one. Because that's more in media. Then if you see the statement of the girl, she simply names all of them and gives them equal role. She does not say this person was more brutal or this person was more brutal, number one. Number two, that is what we've been discussing, that we had challenged the constitutional validity on behalf of the family, of the juvenile, saying that don't give him blanket immunity, because he had the capacity, he had the maturity to know the consequences of his actions and nature of his actions. Treat him like an adult. He so far has not been prosecuted. He has not been tried. He's never been put through the criminal process. Don't give him that immunity. And this law which gives him that immunity should be struck down to that extent. But the court, as I've already pointed out in one para, said that yes, the two systems are completely different, JJ Act and the criminal justice system. Yet in another para says it's not so different. So as to say there's been a substitution or violation of the very way we deal with the criminal, with an accused. And so they declined to strike down that law. And according to me, wrongly. Because had they struck that law, they would have rationalized the system. All the court needed to do was to give a finding that this blanket immunity is not the criteria. There has to be on a case-by-case basis. That would have cured the defect. And that would have stopped many more of this such kind of horrible offences.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you very much, Aman. So nice of you. You have given 48 hours notice. Mm-hmm. He has delivered this lecture. Mm-hmm. One can do PhD.
Thank you.
Take your autograph. I mean, here.
Sure.
Any message also, you can write it.